birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear John and Jenny. Happy birthday to you.
You guys.
Okay. Yeah. Go. Wait. I'm just kidding.
Wow,
too many choices.
Where are you?
Is it too, I'll turn the lights down.
Is it too bright? Are you too famous? Can you hear him?
I'm going to check that.
Adam, my glasses are reflecting everything.
Off? That's fine.
Well, sunglasses?
No, thanks. Yeah, big black sunglasses. Then I can say dumb things, right?
Yeah, it's coming in clear.
It's coming in clear?
Yeah.
So just say your name, Dad, and the day, your birthday year.
My name?
Yeah.
Okay, George. No.
Clooney.
Clooney? No. No, Ronald A. Darby Sr. Yeah. And what else do I want to know?
I
want to
know your birthday.
Is there a month with George?
April.
April. Yeah, okay. April 12th, 1932.
Very good. And where were you born?
In Kingston, Pennsylvania.
And what were your mother's and father's name?
My dad was Sidney, and my mother was Alice.
Yeah. Darby?
Darby, both Darbys right there.
Okay. What is your first memory? Like, how young were you, and what do you remember?
I really had a little trouble with remembering things back then. But I remember stories of people telling me of things. So.
What did you do, Dad?
Well, I was told that they were working in the garden, and I picked up a worm and ate it. Yeah. So how about that?
Do you remember the flavor?
No, I don't remember anything about it.
You just remember being told that?
Sensed they made it up. Yeah.
Did they make up things before about you or to you? Did they pick on you like that?
No.
Was it protein?
No. No, the big thing of all of this about memory is, and I'm not blaming my brother Newman, my older brother, who just died in the last month, but he was 4 years older than me, and he was the most adventurous guy. He invented the sailboard that led to the windsurfer and on and on. But he was always inventing things as a kid, and I was helping him do it. And my parents bought us the casting set for lead soldiers. Back then, the adults were dumb. They didn't know lead was bad and all that. So they sold kids lead things where you melt the lead and the lead smoke came up from the casting and then the kids poured them. Well, I did that with my older brother telling me what to do, but he was 4 years older. I mean, I was like 3 years old and he was seven. He was way up there and I'm down there in the lead smoke. But anyway, I've lost my memory exactly what happened. And I don't blame him, but the whole system.
But you're living longer than either of your brothers. So
well, I'm not complaining. I'm just telling you why things might have occurred as they did. Yeah, okay.
Okay.
There you go.
Cool.
Wow. So, this is fun.
No, that's all true, yeah. It's the way it happens, yeah.
We would like to know how you felt about eating a worm if you really did. Was that a good thing?
Yeah, I think pretty soon most of us will learn how to eat insects, like grasshoppers particularly. Yeah. I mean, as the world, if we aren't going to contain human expansion, we can't feed the world unless we start eating insects. And there's a big motion and things happening here that we can do that. So I was a pioneer, yeah.
Yeah, very good.
Not that a worm's an insect, but.
Where were your mom and dad when all this was happening?
Come on, I don't know.
I just, okay, tell me about first grade.
Either. I mean, they were, the good mom and dad, right. Yeah, but I mean, what?
I just want to know about your school, like in first grade. When you went to first grade, what was your school like? Compared to what school to be like today, what was school like back then?
Okay, when school time came around, I really didn't want to go and stuff. And the school, the physical building, was only like a block and a half away in this borough, which is a town, West Spitzen. And it only took a couple of minutes to walk there and so forth. I went there, and when recess came, because I didn't like it that much, I went home, you know. Everybody got upset and excited, yeah, and stuff like that. So.
Did you? What was school like? Like when I went to Akahi, I went barefoot from kindergarten to sixth grade.
Oh, that's right, Ron.
I mean, what was like? Did you walk to school?
Oh, somebody walked with me. I think we didn't have preschool then. I was probably 6 years old, I guess, yeah. But I think somebody walked with me to school.
Yeah.
And. But we had things called shoes and shoelaces, and you had to tie knots and things that were way beyond your capabilities.
Yeah. But that's like elementary school, right? Like, was it kindergarten?
This is first grade I'm talking about.
Right.
We didn't have kindergarten.
Oh, but did it go, was your school like some schools, small schools, where they go first grade to 12th grade, or was there a middle school? Or?
Well, the school things changed. I mean, the building changed. It was the same school system in the borough of West Pittston, which was a town, if you will, of about 7,000 people in an area between Wilkes-Barre and Scranton, Pennsylvania. So I don't know quite all you're asking me.
I'm just wondering, like, you know, for me, I went to Akahi and then a middle school, then a high school, or some places the school. The whole school is in one building all the way through 12th grade.
Oh, okay. No.
So.
Okay, I started out going to that school real close to my home that I could walk to. But during recess, I was bad. I ran home the first couple of days and got in deep trouble. Yeah.
What happened? Grandma got mad? What did she do to you?
Well, no. Everybody's understanding. What the hell, a dumb little kid. It wasn't that bad, no.
But was school scary right then? Right? Do you remember why you ran home? That was probably not.
It wasn't much fun as staying home, I guess. I don't know. Yeah, I guess so, yeah.
Yeah.
But no, then that school we went to only lasted a while. I mean, things kept changing as they do nowadays. So the school system kept being modified and stuff. So I went to that school a few years, and then an intermediate school, again, walking distance away, and then finally to high school, still a walking distance away, all in this borough or town of West Pittston. Yeah.
So I'm thinking of Falls every time I hear you talk about these days, but that's not Falls. You're in... No. Right.
The little... village or whatever it is of Falls never even was in our minds at then. That came much later on when I was in high school and beyond. Yeah. This is West Pittston.
Okay.
I grew up in West Pittston except for 1 year, moved to Scranton, Pennsylvania.
For 1 year.
Okay. Is that the year? Okay, wait, I want to back up. When did you have the window that the kitty cats were dropped out of in parachutes?
Okay, so I think that was probably, there was a place where a family had owned a house for a long time, and my parents bought it, 226 Park Street, West Pittston, that since then has been totally flooded out and like given away free. In the last 10 years because the Susquehanna River flooded it. But anyway, that place was an old family home And that's the one where I think up in the attic window, we had an experiment with a, are the kitties listening?
I think so.
I don't see it. But anyway, we, my brother, of course, my older brother, yeah, Newman, he invented the parachute for them and said it was okay. And but when we tried to throw the cat out, it went so crazy. Just scratched us and got all wound up, and we gave up and survived ourselves, and the cat survived too. So we didn't parachute any more kitties, yeah.
Didn't you make an airplane to roll off a roof too?
Oh, we tried to make airplanes for little bitty humans like us, yeah, cause, and it didn't work too good. They didn't, but we would get our weight on seesaws or platforms and get the weight and who's going to fly it next and put stones in the cockpit, put it together and hoist it up on the roof to slope down, and we had burlap wings, which were dumb, and it went off and crashed. And wow, it's good we weren't on that. So it was a, we were learning, yeah.
Yeah.
What age were you when you rode your bicycle and had to deliver notices about soldiers? Or can you talk about that a little bit?
Sure. That would be in the middle of World War II. We were in West Pittston, and the local drugstore a block away from our house was Drexler's Drugstore. It was actually a Jewish family. And they did everything there. They, you know, sold prescriptions and had a ice cream parlor and everything. So I worked for them, sweeping the floor, doing ice cream stuff in the ice cream bar, whatever you call it then, banana splits and stuff like that, and stock. Helped them with the stock and arrange things. But during the war, the military used the Western Union to identify parents that children, their kids died, their relatives died in the war, by sending just a telegram. No people or anybody, but a telegram with a gold star you licked on and put on the envelope. And I delivered that. And I was then, I don't know, 14 or 15 years old, and I knew it was heavy stuff, but what do you do?
You had to ride your
knock on the door and say, was and I didn't know these people.
Was that a paid job, or was that a volunteer thing?
Come on, I'm working for a drugstore. I'm either sweeping the floor, making the soda pops and things, or delivering telegrams, whatever they told me to do, I'm paid for it.
How much were they? How much did they pay?
Oh, come on.
You don't know.
Oh, the money was haircuts were 25 cents, and this one was $13. But, yeah, so, yeah.
So, tell me about your being the president of your high school. What did you do? What was your responsibility?
No, I don't think. Was a vice president or president? I forget. I don't know. Where's your yearbook? I don't know. I was one or the other, yeah. It didn't much. It wasn't.
Yeah.
I don't know. One of the, okay, I was trying to get through school and things and play ping pong. I loved ping pong. I was not the star of the school, but I was a good ping pong player.
Was there a team? A ping pong team?
Oh, no. You just... played ping pong. Yeah, yeah.
We
yeah.
played ping pong a lot in the house up there.
Yeah, we
you
used were, to
you
have
beat
ping
us
pong.
All. You were good at it, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. What about Soapbox Derby?
That was a biggie, yeah. Okay, we lived in the little town of West Pittston, across the river from Pittston, forever until one year my dad took a job in Scranton, Pennsylvania, big city, what, 10, 15 miles away, and moved there. And, okay, the Soapbox Derby got started up after World War II ended, and I made a racer for the first year and did it and was a cute looking racer and stuff, but it didn't win anything. It was fun racing. The racing was done at Scranton by getting on a certain street in Scranton, Pennsylvania, and just using gravity, and you went downhill, and there was hundreds of people participating, or 100 or more than 100, each year. It was a big deal, and local businesses sponsored each one. So it was a big deal with the newspaper and everything happening locally. Well, the next year they decided, okay, we're going to engineer this thing, think about it, and do it right and win. So that all the literature, it's sponsored by General Motors and the local newspaper, essentially, the way it's done. And General Motors mechanical people provided all the literature on how to do it and the plans and what best to do, how to streamline your car. You buy the wheels and the axle and the rods and stuff from them. You had to do that to race. So that was all competitive. But then you could do things like upgrade the wheels. You could put jeweler's rouge in kerosene and put the wheels on a bench with the axle and turn it and turn it and get those bearings really perfect and bond and get to know each other good. So we spent hours and hours bonding our wheels that were about that round and putting jeweler's rouge and kerosene in the wheels and really getting our wheels in perfect shape, and we did.
Who's we?
Oh, my brother, Newman. Newman, of course. And Kenny was a little squirt. He's 3 years older than me.
Yeah.
Younger, right? Thank you. Yeah. So I think I was 13 or 14. I was at the edge of what the oldest guys they allowed to race then. So yeah, I mean, he wasn't a little squirt. He was, but he contributed and
so
worked with us.
How come Newman was Newman too old to race? Is that
yes?
What? Oh, okay.
Yes, he was.
Did he race before, or was this the first
no,
time?
No, it was during the war. He wasn't allowed to race because of the limitation. Right, no, he should have, yeah.
Yeah.
But the big deal is the kid's supposed to build the thing yourself, and I did. But you can get help and guidance from your family and anybody. But I physically did build the whole thing myself.
Did your dad help?
In the design of it and all that? Oh, yeah. Dad.
Cool.
Yeah, and the thing that was neat, like, the racing car came up smooth like this and went way up high like this, and the windshield was way, way up front, a plastic thing that round, and then the helmet came here. You had to wear a helmet, and then we had rubber around the cockpit opening so there was no air gaps to cause air resistance. And we had all that worked out, and then our wheels were fine-tuned. But I ran out of time to finish it quite right. The axles came out, and the axle trees are the streamlining around the axles. We didn't have time to do it right. So we said, what the hell? It's a one-day, a couple-minute thing. We'll use cardboard. And we made cardboard airfoil, heavy-duty cardboard, properly done over that. And did it. Anyway, we went in, there was 113 cars completing, and some were so illegal you couldn't believe it. And that's why the whole soapbox derby thing went crazy. Young kids had big plush people providing cars for them. Like we had Wurlitzer jukebox to compete with. They had a factory making plastic. The kid had a plastic car. He was like 11 years old. And his weight to car ratio was better than mine and all of that. And his car was perfect. And everybody said, oh, he's going to win. Finally, Scranton, Pennsylvania is going to be in the news. So our newspaper guys pushed it, and it went on and on, yeah. But we won. I won, yeah.
And did you guys, what did you do after you won? How did you guys celebrate? Do you remember?
Oh, wow. Well, the whole area celebrated. They put you in open, big convertible police cars in the back and in a parade and went
you
by.
You were in it?
Oh, yeah.
It was a star.
Everybody raised and yelled and hollered.
Were you embarrassed or were you like, yeah?
Oh, yeah. Pretty wild. And that happened there in Scranton after winning. Then you fly, we went by train. I've never been on trains before much, or in a high rise. And we went to Akron, Ohio for the national competition. And there you had the same thing. You have police cars driving all through Akron and you're waving out. So it was...
You're like a Miss Pennsylvania.
Yeah, but not pretty.
Yeah.
But anyway, well,
speaking
it was,
of pretty, did girls know?
Oh, girls were screaming.
Because...
Yeah. You know how girls are.
Yeah.
Well, you were 12 or 13?
13 or 14.
Yeah, so.
Yeah.
You probably noticed.
Oh,
them.
I had hair up here and all that stuff. Yeah.
Cool.
Did you have gel? That... Did you have gel for your hair? Was that a...
No, I didn't do that. But I got to go up in an elevator in a building I never did before. And a lot of the other guys were hicks like me. And whenever in the city, we got water balloons and throw them at people down in the streets.
That's cool.
We had a good time in Akron, yeah.
Did you get caught?
Yeah.
No, we were smart. We're smart guys, yeah.
Did any adult come with you?
Yeah, the Scranton Tribune, the major newspaper there, had a full-time reporter, sports reporter, with me all the time, every day, sending back morning and evening edition.
Like
what happened every day.
But no, like, chaperone? Like, you could just do what you want at that age? Was it more like...
Sort of.
Yeah.
I mean, he was a guy happy to get away from work and smoking cigarettes all the time. He was a baseball, football guy. He didn't give a damn about Soapbox Derby.
Or this 13-year-old who was kind of in his care. Would you say you were under his care?
Oh, yeah.
But how much did he care?
No, he was a nice guy.
Yeah, yeah.
But he was a dumb guy. I mean, because the way the race came out, unfortunately, it's an elimination race. Three cars race at once, right? Parallel. And the winner goes, and the others are just thrown out of the race.
Right.
Elimination. But ended up with three cars... one car was way behind, another car and me were a photo finish. And we had to wait a long time until they decided, wow, who won? And they let the other guy win. Oh. And the other guy, who the hell was it? It was a car from Akron, the major city that sponsors this race.
Ah.
It was a plastic car with a little kid doing it, all obviously illegal as hell, because they wanted to keep the record and stuff local.
So you were a threat to them.
Yeah. Meantime, worse than that, I mean, I'm just telling you now that I think back all of that, but is they made me compromise my car with air resistance and stuff that they didn't legally have to, as you read it over, that they had his springs on the, front, like screen door springs to go out to keep, because I didn't have a wheel because of a tiller, and that causes air resistance. And where I had rubber stuff to go around my helmet and the windshield, it made pukas, so the air rustled there. So, I mean, they did crap to slow my car down.
Yeah.
But, I mean, no, shall I keep talking?
Yeah, but what?
Oh, okay.
We'd like to hear it.
But, I mean, the other side, the good guys, for me, were equally corrupt. When they got my car and I won, they said... That car can't win. The World Literature Jukebox plastic car should win. What the hell's going on here? So they actually set up a separate race for he and I, and it's a big street in the city. They had to close it off, and we had police cars around and raced. And I still beat them, you know? They said, whoa. I said, what are we going to do if they said, well, we were going to have you drive his car. I mean, they didn't give a crap about anything.
Wow.
They just wanted to get the town in the news, you know?
Sponsorship.
So I went to as a kid saying, woo, adults ain't that great.
Wow.
Yeah.
So when you got back and all that excitement's over, you're back in your routine again, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
But anyway, let me just say, if I was only smart enough to look back, at one point there, Oh, I didn't tell you the finish of the race. Okay, so it was a photo finish, and this old car from Kansas or some dumb place was way back here, and this other classic car from Akron and I were photo finish. Then as you brake, you put a simple foot brake down on the ground and drag, and you finally stop. Well, the other guy came around and hit the Akron car midship. And knocked it sideways. Didn't hurt anybody, but he broke all of his wheels off. And they were the wheels that they had spent their time, like we did, getting them broken in. So that car never came back. So anyway, I had the fastest car. There were 100,000 spectators there. This is big crap. And if my neat reporter guy wasn't smoking or drinking and playing football and basketball, he should have said, "Wow, we should have won, you know. Yeah. We had the fastest car there. We should have not been thrown out because of the accident." Wasn't an accident, because going back from the thing, the kid from East Podunk or Kansas, where he's from, he was crying. We were both crying. He says, "I got the son of a bitch. I got the son of a bitch." So I mean, I had a great story for him, but he didn't care. He didn't.
Wow. And you cried. I would have cried.
Yeah.
And Newman was at home waiting during all this?
Oh, yeah.
He must have been, like, wishing he was
there. No, we couldn't afford to fly out or back. Yeah. Go by train. Yeah.
Yeah. Wow, that's cool.
Anyway, that all happened, yeah.
Wow, that's a good story.
Wow. It's all true.
Okay, yeah. Well, we're making Dad talk a long time.
Yeah, you know what? We don't have to do... Okay,
Bell wants to...
Oh, just... Dad's got a great story about what happened to that... I mean, it's a historic vehicle, right?
Oh, yeah.
And it was used... Ron, can you describe what happened to it? It was used...
What a follow through, Bill. You're right.
Yeah.
So, this racing car, big heavy wooden racing car, sat in the basement of our house on Philadelphia Avenue there while I was at school at Penn State. And even though the General Motors people and all the newspaper guys stopped the official National Soapbox Derby because of cheating. Because the next year or the one after, the cheating went so obviously beyond, is that the guys, the adults that built the car instead of the kids, they put magnets in the car front. So when the metal gates opened, it gave their car an impulse.
Wow.
And anyway, so they canceled the whole thing. But meantime, the desire to have more little soapbox derbies kept occurring in little towns like around West Spitston, and they would have them just by local police and local people doing honest little things. And, a kid came and said, "Can I use your brother's car?" to my kid, Newman, I guess. And he said, okay, I guess it's okay. So I said, okay, from Penn State, and let them do it. But they got going down the hill, and my car was actually sponsored by a car spring company that didn't give me shock absorbers. So the springs in this dumb hill that they had chosen between Exeter, Pennsylvania and West Pittston, it got the car going like this, and the kid trying to drive it lost control, went into the crowd and hit a woman holding a baby. And we're talking like 30 or 40 miles an hour and a couple hundred pounds of car and guy. And anyway, nobody was killed or there was hurt, and it was bad news. And it was all kind of worked out. So I said, chop the car up and get rid of it before. and that's what they did. Yeah. So that bad end.
That's okay.
Yeah. So it's going to be really hard to recreate that car because the
I got pictures of it. Yeah.
Reginald's gone.
Yeah.
Do you want to take a break, Dad, or you want to keep talking?
Oh, I'm fine. Maybe you guys want to take a break.
I would like to hear about what your decision or how you decided to go to college and what college you went to and
your experience of the whole thing. So when you were a senior in high school, how did you decide to go to college? Because I know no one else in your family had ever gone to college. So.
Yeah, excuse me. Okay, I would like to take a break.
Okay, take a break.
All right.
By getting on a certain street in Scranton, Pennsylvania, and just using gravity, and you went downhill, and there was hundreds of people participating, or 100 or more than 100, each year. It was a big deal, and local businesses sponsored each one. So it was a big deal with the newspaper and everything happening locally. Well, the next year I decided, okay, we're going to engineer this thing, think about it, and do it right and win. So that all the literature, it's sponsored by General Motors and the local newspaper, essentially, the way it's done. And General Motors mechanical people provided all the literature on how to do it and the plans and what best to do, how to streamline your car. You buy the wheels and the axle and the rods and stuff from them. You had to do that to race. So that was all competitive. But then you could do things like upgrade the wheels. You could put jeweler's rouge in kerosene and put the wheels on a bench with the axle and turn it and get those bearings really perfect and bond and get to know each other good. So we spent hours and hours bonding our wheels that were about that round and putting jeweler's rouge and kerosene in the wheels and really getting our wheels in perfect shape, and we did.
Who's we?
Oh, my brother, Newman, of course. And Kenny was a little squirt. He's 3 years older than me.
Yeah.
Younger, right, thank you, yeah. So I think I was 13 or 14. I was at the edge of what the oldest guys they allowed to race then. So yeah, I mean, he wasn't a little squirt. He was, but he contributed and so worked with us.
How come Newman was Newman too old to race? Is that
yes?
What? Oh, okay.
Yes, he was.
Did he race before, or was this the first
no,
time?
No, it was during the war. He wasn't allowed to race because of the limitation. Right. No, he should have. Yeah.
Yeah.
But the big deal is the kid's supposed to build the thing yourself, and I did. But you can get help and guidance from your family and anybody. But I physically did build the whole thing myself.
Did your dad help?
In the design of it and all that? Oh, yeah.
Oh,
dad.
Cool.
Yeah, and the thing that was neat, like, the racing car came up smooth like this and went way up high like this. And the windshield was way, way up front, a plastic thing that round. And then the helmet came here. You had to wear a helmet. And then we had rubber around the cockpit opening so there was no air gaps to cause air resistance. And we had all that worked out. And then our wheels were fine-tuned. But I ran out of time to finish it quite right. The axles came out, and the axle trees are the streamlining around the axles. We didn't have time to do it right. So we said, what the hell? It's a one day, a couple minute thing. We'll use cardboard. And we made cardboard airfoil, heavy duty cardboard, properly done over that and did it. Anyway, we went in, there was 113 cars completing, and some were so illegal you couldn't believe it. And that's why the whole soapbox derby thing went crazy. Young kids had big plush people providing car phone. Like we had Wurlitzer jukebox to compete with. They had a factory making plastic. The kid had a plastic car. He was like 11 years old and his weight to car ratio was better than mine and all of that. And his car was perfect. And everybody said, oh, he's going to win. Finally, Scranton, Pennsylvania is going to be in the news. So our newspaper guys pushed it and pushed it. And it went on and on, yeah. But we won, I won, yeah.
And did you guys, what'd you do after you won? How'd you guys celebrate, do you remember?
Oh, wow. Well, the whole area celebrated. They put you in open, big convertible police cars in the back and in a parade and went
you
by.
You were in it? Oh, yeah.
He was a star.
Everybody raised and yelled and hollered. Oh, really?
Were you embarrassed or were you like, yeah?
Oh, yeah. Pretty wild. And that happened there in Scranton after winning. Then you fly, no, we went by train. I've never been on trains before much or in a high rise. And we went to Akron, Ohio for the, you know, the national competition. And there you had the same thing. You have police cars driving all through Akron and you're waving out. So it was...
You're like a Miss Pennsylvania.
Yeah, but not pretty.
Yeah.
But anyway, well,
speaking
it was,
of pretty, did girls notice?
Oh, girls were screaming, yeah. You know how girls are.
Yeah.
Well, you were 12 or 13?
13 or 14.
Yeah, so.
Yeah.
Probably no.
Oh,
them.
I had hair up here and yeah. All that stuff, yeah.
Cool.
Did you have gel? Did you have gel for your hair? Was that a
no, I didn't do that. But I got to go up in an elevator in a building I never did before. And a lot of the other guys were hicks like me. And whenever in the city, what do we got water balloons and throw them at people down in the streets.
That's cool.
We had a good time in Akron, yeah.
Did you get caught?
Yeah.
No, we were smart. We're smart guys, yeah.
Did any adult come with you? Or did
Yeah, the Scranton Tribune, the major newspaper there, had a full-time reporter, sports reporter, with me all the time, every day, sending back morning and evening edition.
Like
what happened every day.
But no, like, chaperone, like, you could just do what you want at that age? Was it more like...
Sort of.
Yeah.
I mean, he was a guy happy to get away from work and smoking cigarettes all the time. He was a baseball, football guy. He didn't give a damn about Soapbox Derby.
Or this 13-year-old who was kind of in his care. Would you say you were under his care?
Oh, yeah.
But how much did he care?
No, he was a nice guy.
Yeah.
But he was a dumb guy. I mean, because the way the race came out, unfortunately, it's an elimination race. Three cars race at once, right? Parallel. And the winner goes, and the others are just thrown out of the race.
Right.
Elimination. But ended up with three cars... one car was way behind, another car and me were a photo finish. And we had to wait a long time until they decided, wow, who won? And they let the other guy win. Oh. And the other guy, who the hell was it? It was a car from Akron, the major city that sponsors this race. It was a plastic car with a little kid doing it, all obviously illegal as hell, because they wanted to keep the record and stuff local.
So you were a threat to them.
Yeah. Meantime, worse than that, I mean, I'm just telling you now that I think back all of that one, is they made me compromise my car with air resistance and stuff that they didn't legally have to, as you read it over, that they added springs on the, like screen door springs to go out to keep, because I didn't have a wheel because of a tiller, and that caused air resistance. And where I had rubber stuff to go around my helmet and the windshield, it made pukas, so the air rustled there. So, I mean, they did crap to slow my car down.
Yeah.
But, I mean, shall I keep talking?
Yeah, but what?
Oh, okay.
We'd like to hear
but, I mean, the other side, the good guys, for me, were equally corrupt. When they got my car and I won, they said... That car can't win. The World Literature Jukebox plastic car should win. What the hell's going on here? So they actually set up a separate race for he and I, and it's a big street in the city. They had to close it off, and we had police cars around and raced. And I still beat them, you know? They said, whoa. I said, what are we going to do if they said, well, we were going to have you drive his car. I mean, they didn't give a crap about anything.
Wow.
They just wanted to get the town in the news, you know?
Sponsorship.
So I went to as a kid saying, woo, adults ain't that great.
Wow.
Yeah.
So when you got back and all that excitement's over, you're back in your routine again, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
But anyway, let me just say, if I was only smart enough to look back, at one point there, oh, I didn't tell you the finish of the race. Okay, so it was a photo finish, and this old car from Kansas or some dumb place was way back here, and this other classic car from Akron and I were photo finish. Then as you brake, you put a simple foot brake down on the ground and drag, 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 and you finally stop. Well, the other guy came around and hit the Akron car midship and knocked it sideways. Didn't hurt anybody, but he broke all of his wheels off. And they were the wheels that they had spent their time, like we did, getting them broken in. So that car never came back. So anyway, I had the fastest car. There were 100,000 spectators there. This is big crap. And if my neat reporter guy wasn't smoking or drinking and playing football and basketball, he should have said, "Wow, we should have won, you know. Yeah. We had the fastest car there. We should have not been thrown out because of the accident. Wasn't an accident." Because going back from the thing, the kid from East Podunk or Kansas, wherever he's from, he was crying. We were both crying. He says, "I got the son of a bitch. I got the son of a bitch." So I mean, I had a great story for him, but he didn't care. He didn't.
Wow. And you cried. I would have cried.
Yeah.
And Newman was at home waiting during all this?
Oh, yeah.
He must have been, like, wishing he was
there. No, we couldn't afford to fly out or back. Yeah, fly. I mean, go by train. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Wow. That's
cool. Anyway, that all happened. Yeah.
Wow, that's a good story.
Wow. It's all true.
Okay. Yeah. Well, we're making Dad talk a long time.
Yeah. You know what? We don't have to do. Okay.
Bell wants to.
Oh, just Dad's got a great story about what happened to that. I mean, it's a historic vehicle, right?
Oh yeah.
And it was used. Ron, can you describe what happened to it? It was used.
What a follow through, Bill.
Yeah,
you're right.
Yeah.
So, this racing car, big heavy wooden racing car, sat in the basement of our house on Philadelphia Avenue there while I was at school at Penn State. And even though the General Motors people and all the newspaper guys stopped the official National Soapbox Derby because of cheating. Because the next year or the one after, the cheating went so obviously beyond, is that the guys, the adults that built the car instead of the kids, they put magnets in the car front. So when the metal gates opened, it gave their car an impulse.
Wow.
And anyway, so they canceled the whole thing. But meantime, the desire to have more little soapbox derbies kept occurring in little towns like around West Spitston, and they would have them just by local police and local people doing honest little things. And, a kid came and said, "Can I use your brother's car?" to my kid, Newman, I guess. And he said, okay, I guess it's okay. So I said, okay, from Penn State, and let them do it. But they got going down the hill, and my car was actually sponsored by a car spring company that didn't give me shock absorbers. So the springs in this dumb hill that they had chosen between Exeter, Pennsylvania and West Pittston, it got the car going like this, and the kid trying to drive it lost control, went into the crowd and hit a woman holding a baby. And we're talking like 30 or 40 miles an hour and a couple hundred pounds of car and guy. And anyway, nobody was killed or there was hurt, and it was bad news. And it was all kind of worked out. So I said, chop the car up and get rid of it before. and that's what they did. Yeah. So that bad end.
That's okay.
Yeah. So it's going to be really hard to recreate that car because
I got pictures of it. Yeah,
original's gone.
Yeah.
Do you want to take a break, Dad, or you want to keep talking?
Oh, I'm fine. Maybe you guys want to take a break.
I would like to hear about what your decision or how you decided to go to college and what college you went to and your experience of the whole thing. So when you're a senior in high school, how did you decide to go to college? Because I know no one else in your family had ever gone to college. So.
Yeah, excuse me. Okay, I would like to take a break.
Okay, take a break.
All right. All right. Second?
Yeah. Okay, what?
What were you going to talk about? The car. You said you're in the kitchen.
Okay, this is about the Soapbox Derby race in 1946, I guess it was. Whenever it was. I want to explain, after I won, I got really amazed the way people reacted and stuff about what's right and what's wrong. And the guys on our side wanted us to win was the Scranton Tribune, one of the two biggest newspapers in Scranton. And what you call it, Chevrolet company had places all over the area. They were dumping everything in to make me win. So they took my Soapbox Derby into their shops and worked it over. They ground down all the stuff I did with best cheap hand sandpapering I did and made it smooth. And they took those cardboard airfoils over the axle trees and replaced them with high aluminum, aircraft aluminum high grain materials. And made it, I mean, in other words, they made that car like, whoopee! Yeah, if it was fast then, it was faster now. So that's how it went to Akron. But, I mean, that was all illegal. I mean, they shouldn't have been doing that. It was supposed to be a kid stuff. So that went in my mind as a kid as to what kind of world I'm going into. So that's it.
And were you right?
Yeah. Ask the military-industrial complex about that. Yeah, they know that crap. Yeah. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Okay, we're going to back up because some people have questions about your father and your father's father. If we could just understand, like, your father's name was Sidney Darby, but his father's name was Otis?
Otis.
And what did Otis Darby do, and do you remember him?
Yes, I remember Otis Darby. I remember Otis Darby last when Millie and I took this little lady here as a tiny baby to where he had a church in the Pocono Mountains.
Oh, I didn't know you got baptized by Otis.
He wasn't baptized by Otis.
Oh,
Otis was very ill and... And hardly, I don't know his final age, close to 90, I think, or maybe in his 90s, I'm not too sure, we can check that. But he just held the baby and said, where's mom? Millie?
Sweetness.
What did he say?
Sweetness.
Sweetness. He just looked at it and said, sweetness. Yeah.
Sweetness.
Yeah, there we go. Oh. And there she is still. Sweetness, yeah.
What did he do for a living, Otis Darby?
Lots of things. Okay. I'm sorry, I'm caught off guard. I would have to think about it stronger. But originally, things he've done, it was musical piano tuning. He did a lot of professional tuning of pianos. He was into music to some extent, and probably more than I'm discussing.
What was his first profession? Minister.
I don't really know.
Yes, you do, honey. Baptist minister.
Well, somehow he got into the ministry, yeah. And well, actually, he was a minister for an organized Baptist church. And this is Northern Baptist, which is quite different than some of the Southern Baptists, as you guys know, and more rigid and so forth, different way. But yeah, but what, during World War I was a million, I guess? Yeah. He became a conscientious objector. to warfare and things, and spoke out against it so strong that he lost, I don't know about all this for sure, but he lost his following and got kicked out or quit and did other things, including, non-religious stuff, piano tuning, and I don't know what else. What do you know about Mel?
Well, when we went there, Aunt Nana were running a little mission for people with problems. And he was still preaching.
Good, yeah. So he made little missions for poor people, didn't have big bucks, and homeless, and stuff like that, right? And my aunt Nina ran a little mission up there in the Pocono Mountains. Yeah.
Cool.
Nice. Yeah.
And Grandpa was a little kid then?
Yeah.
My grandpa, your dad, was a little kid at that time?
No. No, 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 no. I mean, this is, I mean, come on. What are you asking me, man?
Well, this is your grandfather you're talking about, right?
Yeah.
Which is your father's father, right? So, I don't know the time frame of this. I don't know who was born or...
Did Sidney Darby grow up? Where did Sidney Darby grow up? Your dad. Where did he grow up?
I hear you. Good question. Oh, pretty much in West Pittston.
Okay.
Pretty much, and that's where, yeah, okay, so Grandpa was pretty much all that time, my grandpa, in West Pittston, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, and that's where I think he was primarily doing piano tuning and I guess some degree of teaching and ministering and so forth, right?
Is that how Grandpa learned, your dad learned how to be musical?
The violin and the piano.
Yeah, when my father was in high school and graduated, he had a band. He was the leader of a band using a violin and had a hot violin for all the kids of his age and stuff to dance to and things like that, and made some kind of a living out of it.
Is it like jazz, or what kind of music would that be called?
I don't know.
Was there a singer too, or just instrumental?
I don't know much about it, frankly.
Okay. All right.
But I knew all through my life he played the violin when he wasn't working or doing other things, and he'd play old Danny Boy and semi-classical stuff, and it was beautiful, yeah.
Wow. That's cool.
Yeah.
And your dad made a living as an artist, is that correct?
Well, he had made a living however he could by using art in actually sign painting, and sign painting at that time included things like, when he was very young, working for the big motion picture theater in Pittston, Pennsylvania. Pittston's the city across the river from Susquehanna River from West Pittston, where we all grew up, and it was a miniature city, I'd say population of 30,000-40,000 or something like that, but it had a main street and shops on it, and a large cinema theater built for, I think, 1,000 people. I mean,
wow,
that's not tiny, right?
Yeah.
And this is in an area, again, between Wilkes-Barre and Scranton, where it was pretty dense population all the way, but split up with little boroughs or town all the way along that edged into each other, that later all combined and stuff. But while we were there, it was sort of split up. But anyway, he worked for then, at that time, when motion pictures came through, and this is probably about 1920, I guess, or something. Anyway, I wasn't even born. Nellie and I were born in 1932. So this is when he was born in 1905. So 20 years, 1923. This is about the late 20s and early 30s, I guess, when he was doing this. And they used to have breaks in the main motion picture thing, vaudeville, is that what it is, vaudeville? Uh-huh. Yeah, and he talked about meeting all the people that came through. But anyway, in terms of his artwork and stuff, they would send black and white photographs of who's going to be in this big production coming up, and they'd have a couple of weeks to work and plan on doing artwork to put big advertising things around, all hand done, using watercolor pretty much, and from the black and white photo, and they'd have to work up advertising things manually, not big machines automatically rolling them out. So he was involved with that. And one thing I remember which was impressed me is that one time Mom was always bitching about not get paid enough or get home and all that. He was trying to get home early and he couldn't get out. He remembered he left something in a room in the theater before he left. When he opened the door and went in there, it was completely dark, and he went in the room trying to figure out where he left his thing, and something came down and rubbed across him. And anyway, wow, he remembered that the actor in vaudeville included a small elephant, and they stuck him in that room when they went for dinner. And he came in the room, and this elephant came and went through all of his pockets looking for peanuts. And like, he wasn't sure what the hell was going to happen. But anyway, he got out. So he had a bunch of neat experiences, yeah.
Wow, that could have been the end of our whole family.
Yeah, well, before he did that, before he settled down, that was settling down, he decided to see the world a little bit anyway, and he jumped on a ship, a banana ship, from New York. Oh, he went to New York City and lived in Greenwich Village a while and had some experiences there they'll talk about where the artists worked. And then he got bored with that stuff of those New York City guys, like Lisa must have experienced, yeah. And decided he wanted to go abroad, so he jumped on the banana ship as the bottomest thing you could ever do in a banana ship. I don't know what it was. But they went down to Nicaragua or someplace like that. And it was just so far out for him to be in a ship in the ocean and seeing all that stuff. And then when he got off the ship, he and a buddy from the ship weren't sure what to do in this strange town. And they were told to be careful, don't move around. And there were guys with armed rifles standing all around. And they know, he and his buddy noticed this one guy was sleeping. And they said, let's go and see if we can get his rifle. And the dummies did. They went over there and took his rifle away, but the guy didn't wake up. Anyway, nothing came out of that. They fortunately didn't pursue anything, but they succeeded in taking his rifle while he was sleeping.
So
but,
Grandpa used to tell you these stories? Like, huh? Grandpa used to sit down and tell you these stories, your dad?
Well, yeah, that's how I heard it. Yeah. Well, cool. Not that many, I mean, very few, but that maybe he had other ones he didn't tell me. But, but he told me that one, yeah.
That's cool.
Yeah.
So how did you get into boats?
Well, the Susquehanna River, right?
Right. Oh, that's true.
Yeah, we lived on the beautiful Susquehanna River, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
And we always, and Newman again, he was the guy, he was the boat guy. And I was a little kid 4 years behind him, and he was building boats and I was helping him. And we had a garage there and we built boats. And during World War II, everybody came to watch us build boats, but then we were trying to be patriotic too. And back then, you were supposed to collect string, and people would bring in string and newspapers, and we would recycle them for the war effort. And it was a big thing. Our garage on 226 Park Street was full of people building boats, bringing stuff in for the war effort and so forth, yeah.
And you said once you used to collect dandelions to make soup?
Oh, there was hard times. I mean, the anthracite region was in recession starting 1932 when everything, 1929, the whole thing crashed. Our coal mines had already crashed, anthracite. Coal wasn't doing good. So times were tough to get work. And my father then was a sign painter working for individual shops to do signs and things. And business was up and down, and sometimes we looked for dandelions out in the yard, and my mother would cook them and eat them. They're very healthy, yeah. Mm-hmm. And stuff like that happens, yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So, what else do you remember of those days when it was hard days? What else do you remember about food, about clothes, about fun?
Oh, everything was solid and nice. My folks never cursed or used bad words. Little town of West Pittston had a railroad track running right through it, and it was separated. On one side were the, on the good side of the river where we live, where the WASP, White Anglican Protestants, lived. On the other side were the others. And so the others were people that used to work, or did still maybe work, with the, what was left of the anthracite coal mines. And they were, you know, immigrants. They were immigrants from Italy, Poland, and wherever. A few different ones, and they all had names like WASP, Kikes, and so. And we never used that terminology in our family and all of that. And my mother went heavily to the church and took us to the Baptist church. My father never went to any churches, but those things all happened and during that.
So you didn't feel like you were poor then, did you? Or you didn't feel?
No,
like...
we didn't feel we were poor. We felt we had really. My father always got the New York Times Sunday. I mean, wow, we could. I can hardly afford the New Year's time now, but how did he do? But no, I mean, he was a classy guy. Yeah. And oh, he did portraits. Besides sign painting, he would get contracts to do portraits. Mm-hmm. Like the, it's funny, the, who's the head man of the high schools? The
principal.
The super principal of all the high schools.
Superintendent.
Superintendent of all the high schools there. What was his name? I forget my name. The great big tall 6 foot guy from out in the farm area and had a bunch of big kids and all of that. And everybody respected him. And we always started, every morning had to go to a chapel with him talking, reading from the Bible and stuff and all of this great stuff. And then we found out later on that he wasn't so great, and stuff like that.
What did he do?
He was making out with his secretary. That was an ugly, I thought, old lady there. But anyway, they had a thing going. That was a big thing. But anyway, my father, before they knew all that, got a contract to do his portrait because he was going to retire finally. And my father did his portrait wonderfully. But he turned out to be an asshole. Yeah. Anyway, stuff like that.
Well,
same old story.
Well, let's go. We can jump around. Tell us about the time when you found out you guys are coming to Hawaii with your job.
Oh, wow.
Did you know what you're getting into?
That's heavy duty stuff.
Oh, yeah?
Oh, yeah, well, okay, I don't know how much time we
have. If you don't want to go into an hour.
No, no.
Can we go to tobacco picking real fast?
Okay.
That's from the olden days.
Oh, yeah.
How did you end up doing that? And,
okay.
What was that like?
I mean, we were kind of destitute in that area, again, because the anthracite coal mine sort of collapsed. The whole community sort of collapsed, even though we were never miners, or family was, but things that my family made businesses from. Okay, so you're asking, coal mining, yeah.
How you
I was going to talk about another
tobacco.
Thing. Oh, yeah, tobacco, okay. Well, okay, my folks, Okay, my father didn't believe in college, and he didn't want me to go. He didn't want Newman to go to college. Newman didn't want that either, and I did. And my father didn't want me to go and said it's worth the time. It's not. And my argument with my mother. My other mother wanted me to do. I mean, at least try for scholarship. And they said, no. So I was trying to figure out how to go to college. And then I heard that because other people kind of in my situation there were aware of it, a company that grew shade-grown tobacco in Connecticut wanted workers. And they couldn't get cheap workers locally. The kids were all too smart to do that and too wealthy to do that. So they imported us Mexicans, from Pennsylvania to go up there and go up there and pick their dumb tobacco. And that was an experience. I did it for 2 summers full time, yeah. And what you do is you get there in the spring, early spring, and the tobacco plants are small, and they put a mark on your arm so that you reach in, you sit in the mud in between 2 rows of tobacco plants. Oh, that has a shade-growing plant. They have poles going up, and they have white canvas-type stuff over acres and acres of land there to build up the heat inside so it approximates the temperature. The outdoor thermal temperature. Oh, is the camera off?
No.
Oh, what? Oh, camera. So that the inside temperature is like that of Sumatra, in the Sumatra Island, way down in the dumb Pacific someplace. And the soil was right. So that's where we were. And you sit in your rear end in the spring, and I got a sore arm here now. Reach over until the leaf tip hit that mark, and then you would pick that singular leaf carefully and put it on your lap, and then move forward and the next plant and pick a leaf until you had a pad of leaves about yay tall. And you want to poke holes in them because these were leaves that were going to be tenderly cured to wrap cigars and cigars type things with, so you could smoke through them. Very expensive things. So that's what we did. Yeah, and you pick this side, and get in there. And then that was boring as hell. And the next year, for some reason, our school counselor was serving as in charge of this camp that was set up in the farm field as the head person, whatever you call that, of it. And he wanted me to be the houseboy, if I would, and it paid better than picking tobacco. And I had to work with 20 gang toilets and stuff like that. And it was better than picking. Was less boring than picking tobacco. So I became the houseboy for a year working there and had lots of experiences on both sides of the business, yeah.
That's cool.
Did you say college? Was that college? Was that at university or at high school?
This is 11th grade and 12th grade.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, I did that. I mean, the summers there after, between 11th grade. And I guess after 12th grade, and then I went to Penn State, yeah. But made better money doing that, yeah, uh-huh.
Cool.
Yeah.
Cool. All right, how you doing? You want to take a break or stop? Or?
Yeah, we can do more another day if you want, Dad.
I'm sorry, what?
You want to keep going? You want to stop?
I'm fine if you guys are. If you guys are bored, I'll quit or whatever.
I'm not bored.
No, we're not bored.
Oh, I'm fine. Unless you don't think I'm fine.
So what was the best Christmas present you got from your dad?
You and your brother.
Oh, yeah, I can tell you that.
Okay.
Oh, wow.
Wow. Johnny Jenkins was my best friend. And he was the smartest guy in the school. Man, was he smart. And he was my buddy. And I was the second smartest guy in the school. And Johnny Jenkins was right down the block. And his parents were kind of rich compared to us in that way. He's a single kid. And he had the best train set and all of that stuff. So anyway, I was just saying about Johnny Jenkins.
Oh, stop for one.
String and newspapers. And we would recycle them for the war effort. And it was a big thing. Our garage on 226 Park Street was full of people building boats, bringing stuff in for the war effort and so forth, yeah.
And you said once you used to collect dandelions to make soup?
Oh, there was hard times. I mean, the anthracite region was in recession starting 1932 when everything, 1929, the whole thing crashed. Our coal mines had already crashed anthracite. Coal wasn't doing good. So times were tough to get work. And my father then was a sign painter working for individual shops to do signs and things. And business was up and down. And sometimes we looked for dandelions out in the yard and my mother would cook them and we'd eat them. They're very healthy, yeah. Mm-hmm. And stuff like that happens, yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
What else do you remember of those days when it was hard days? What else do you remember about food, about clothes, about fun?
Oh, everything was solid and nice. My folks never cursed or used bad words. Little town of West Pittston had a railroad track running right through it, and it was separated. On one side were on the good side of the river where we lived, where the WASP, White Anglican Protestants, lived. On the other side were the others. And so the others were people that used to work, or did still maybe work, with what was left of the anthracite coal mines. And they were, you know, immigrants. They were immigrants from Italy, Poland, and wherever. A few different ones, and they all had names like WAPs, Kikes, and so. And we never used that terminology in our family and all of that. And my mother went heavily to the church and took us to the Baptist church. My father never went to any churches. But those things all happened and during that.
So you didn't feel like you were poor then, did you? Or you didn't feel
we didn't feel we were poor. We felt we had really. My father always got the New York Times Sunday. I mean, wow, I could. I can hardly afford the New York Times now. But how did he do? But no, I mean, he was a classy guy. Yeah. And he did portraits. Besides sign painting, he would get contracts to do portraits. Mm-hmm. Like the, it's funny, the, who's the head man of the high schools? The
principal.
The super principal of all the high schools.
Superintendent.
Superintendent of all the high schools there. What was his name? I forget my name. The great big tall 6 foot guy from out in the farm area and had a bunch of big kids and all of that, and everybody respected him, and we always started every morning, had to go to a chapel with him talking, reading from the Bible and stuff, and all of this great stuff. And then we found out later on that he wasn't so great, and stuff like that.
What did he do?
He was making out with his secretary. That was an ugly, I thought, old lady there. But anyway, they had a thing going. That was a big thing. But anyway, my father, before they knew all that, got a contract to do his portrait because he was going to retire finally. And my father did his portrait wonderfully. But he turned out to be an asshole. Yeah. Anyway, stuff like that.
Well,
same old story.
Well, let's go. We can jump around. Tell us about the time when you found out you guys are coming to Hawaii with your job.
Oh, wow.
Did you know what you're getting into?
That's heavy duty stuff.
Oh, yeah?
Oh, yeah. Well, okay. I don't know how much time we
have. If you don't want to go into an hour.
Can we go to tobacco picking real fast?
Okay.
That's from the olden days.
Oh, yeah.
How did you end up doing that? And
okay.
What was that like?
I mean, we were kind of destitute in that area, again, because the anthracite coal mines sort of collapsed. The whole community sort of collapsed, even though we were never miners, or family was, but the things that my family made businesses from. Okay, so you're asking, coal mine, yeah.
How you got
I was going to talk about another thing. Oh, yeah, tobacco, okay. Well, okay, my father didn't believe in college, and he didn't want me to go, he didn't want Newman to go to college, Newman didn't want that either, and I did, and my father didn't want me to go and said, it's worth the time, it's not, and my argument with my mother wanted me to do, I mean, at least try for scholarship, and they said, no, so I was trying to figure out how to go to college. And then I heard that because other people kind of in my situation there were aware of it, a company that grew shade-grown tobacco in Connecticut wanted workers, and they couldn't get cheap workers locally. The kids were all too smart to do that. And too wealthy to do that. So they imported us Mexicans, from Pennsylvania to go up there and go up there and pick their dumb tobacco. And that was an experience. I did it for 2 summers full time, yeah. And what you do is you get there in the early spring, and the tobacco plants are small. And they put a mark on your arm so that you reach in, you sit in the mud in between 2 rows of tobacco plants. Oh, that has a shade-growing plant. They have poles going up, and they have white canvas-type stuff over acres and acres of land there to build up the heat inside so it approximates the outdoor thermal temperature. Oh, is the camera off?
No.
Oh, camera. So that the inside temperature is like that of Sumatra, in the Sumatra Island, way down in the dumb Pacific someplace. And the soil was right. So that's where we were. And you sit in your rear end in the spring, and I got a sore arm here now. Reach over until the leaf tip hit that mark, and then you would pick that singular leaf carefully and put it on your lap, and then move forward and the next plant and pick a leaf until you had a pad of leaves about yay tall, and you want to poke holes in them because these were leaves that were going to be tenderly cured to wrap cigars and cigars type things with, so you could smoke through them. Very expensive thing. So that's what we did. Yeah. And you pick this side, and get in there. And then that was boring as hell. And the next year, for some reason, our school counselor was serving as in charge of this camp that was set up in the farm field as the head person, whatever you call that, of it. And he wanted me to be the houseboy, if I would, and it paid better than picking tobacco. And I had to work with 20 gang toilets and stuff like that. And it was better than picking. It was less boring than picking tobacco. So I became the houseboy for a year working there, and had lots of experiences on both sides of the business, yeah.
That's cool.
Did you say college? Was that college? Is that at university or at high school?
Oh, man, this is 11th grade and 12th grade.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, I did that. I mean, the summers there, between 11th grade. And I guess after 12th grade, and then I went to Penn State, yeah. but made better money doing that. Yeah,
Cool.
Yeah.
Cool. All right, how you doing? You want to take a break or stop? Or?
Yeah, we can do more another day if you want, Dad.
I'm sorry, what?
You want to keep going? You want to stop?
I'm fine if you guys are. If you guys are bored, I'll quit or whatever.
I'm not bored.
No, we're not bored.
Oh, I'm fine. Unless you don't think I'm fine.
So what was the best Christmas present you got from your dad?
You and your brother.
Oh, yeah, I can tell you that.
Okay.
Oh, wow.
Wow. Johnny Jenkins was my best friend. And he was the smartest guy in the school. Man, was he smart. And he was my buddy. And I was the second smartest guy in the school. And Johnny Jenkins was right down the block. And his parents were kind of rich compared to us in that way. He's a single kid. And he had the best train set and all of that stuff. So anyway, I'm just saying about Johnny Jenkins.
Oh, stop for one. Okay, you're back on.
Johnny Jenkins and the trains.
Johnny Jenkins, and how does that have to do with Christmas?
Right, best Christmas present, Johnny Jenkins. Pick it up.
Oh, okay. Well, when Christmas came, kids would move around and look at. Back there, we had a Christmas tree in the living room, an electric train set around the bottom all the time, and little towns and houses, and everybody was judged by how great their Christmas was on those things.
Yeah, we used to do that.
The way it was, yeah. So anyway, you got the best out of that. And my God, my dad, he'd forget about Christmas. We tried so hard working, trying to earn a living. And my mother was like, oh, and we wouldn't get a Christmas tree. And finally, Christmas, day before Christmas, he'd bring some crappy thing and say, I'm sorry, you're the tree, and we get a tree and all that. But then under the tree, he put stuff for us. One year he just put tools, saws, things, and hammers, and vices, and all kinds. He said, do whatever you want, you know, and boards. And all of our friends came, and they had more fun at our house than all the expensive crap that Madison Avenue sold them. Yeah, so that was good. Yeah. Yeah.
No,
he's a good dad, yeah.
What happened to him? Did he go to college too?
My dad?
No, Johnny
Jenkins.
Oh, indeed he did. A last track of him. Actually, I'll tell you, it's funny. He became a general in the U.S. Army, and he got a Ph.D. And what the hell else was it? I just lost track of him, but he went whoops way up and disappeared. I lost track of him. Yeah. Yeah. PhD and a general. What more do you want, right?
I don't know. I would like to hear, I have heard stories about you in college when you had to earn your own way in school, cleaning toilets of frat houses. Is that right?
Wait, me in college?
No, just you in college.
Oh, in college. I'm sorry.
What did you do to make earn money. Your way?
Get through.
That was bad, yeah. Okay, I went to Penn State, and Penn State was picked to be in the middle of the state of Pennsylvania because Pittsburgh and Philadelphia are arguing where it should be. Put it in the boonies of nowhere, you know. So at that time, Penn State, when I went to 1946, I guess? I graduated in 50, figured out. No, I graduated in 54. I went there in 50, I guess. Okay. Where's mom?
She's shaking her head, yes. You're good.
Excuse me.
Mom's fact checking you the whole time, Dad.
Yeah, I know, but she should yell. But she keeps saying, I talk too much.
She's not saying that.
Anyway.
See, that would be good if we asked Millie the same question. About your story.
Yeah, the honeymoon. No, put it in different rooms.
Wait a minute. Mine is all hearsay. I was not there, okay. But I've heard stories.
All right, then we'll have to hear your story.
Yeah, I want to hear Dad's story about college.
Okay, so you could hardly get to Penn State, damn it. There's no airport, there's no railroad. There was a Greyhound bus that sort of did it. So you hitchhike, mostly hitchhiked a lot of time to get there. But anyway, I got there and they let me in. We got stuff together, but no financial help from my parents. What they did, my parents did do, is they do my laundry, my mother. He had a cardboard suitcase, and when I got it full of dirty clothes, I'd mail it back, 200 miles away to eastern Pennsylvania or whatever distance, and then she'd launder it and mail it back, and so, because there was no laundromats or anything, but at least that helped make things work. So what did I do? So I got there, and as a new, just like Keikoa, going to Montana, they made him stay in the dormitories. Mm-hmm. And just like nephew-in-law, what's Wendy's son called?
Riley.
But what's his thing? He's a
freshman in college.
Community. Well, I mean, Wendy is a... Her daughter is, I'm trying to say what her his technical name is, but maybe it doesn't matter. You know what I mean?
He's your niece's son.
Yeah, anyway, he's been forced to live in dormitories, even though he's a couple miles away from his house, which is, you know, a ripoff. The university is just trying to get more money. And that's what happened to me. It was a brand new building, never occupied, was girl dorms, no urinals, and they had to live in them with a bunch of guys, which were fine. I know guys are okay, but it was sucking up my money too much, and I had to petition them to let me out of the dorms if I'm going to stay on for the next semester. Fortunately, I got on a graduate... list or a dean's list, yeah, and all that, and that impressed them enough to call me destitute, I think. I had to legally sign a paper that I didn't have to stay in their damn dorms. And the stuff like that, you know, the system is tough.
Well, where did you stay?
Oh, in rat-stinking places that were cheap. A guy died and the smell was bad. Yeah, but anyway, they weren't nice, yeah. And I worked for meals in classy frat houses, fraternity houses. Yeah, and did I specials in pots and pans, yeah. Yeah, so I got a PhD in pots and pans, yeah. No, anyway, that was only for two years or so. Then I got all kinds of other jobs. Oh, in my first year, before I even got out of the dorms, I got jobs doing windows, artistically designing the windows for a clothing store. And to do that, my friends who were fellow West Pittston guys who parents helped fund them, we took the big sliding doors off the beautiful new garage or closet doors and laid them down and could put paper on them and make designs for this thing. So anyway, it all worked out, yeah.
Wow. What about the cockroaches in the train track? I heard a story once about cockroaches.
Oh, that's Roy Kylander. I just talked with him today. Commended with him today, yeah. Yeah, he was a buddy who used to sail boats, graduated with me from high school from West Pittston, mm-hmm. and he was kind of a wealthy guy compared to me, and he always had little funky boats, and we went sailing in them, and one way or the other, and one time we capsized badly after a couple of days out, and ruined my brother's camera, but anyway, whatever. Oh, okay. Then he finally got his act together and went to school and at Penn State, and then we reconnected. And but he was always in model railroads, and he took his HO gauge railroads with him, and he would he would put glue on the track, airplane glue, and put a cockroach on it, go around and run it over, and stuff like that.
But, that sounds good. Hey, Dad, I also have a question. I heard that you joined the Army briefly. Is that true? Is that rumor true?
Who, me?
Yeah.
No, I was in the Army, Navy, and Air Force, and nobody ever thought of me as a veteran, okay?
Yeah.
Okay, when I was in high school, somehow the Navy said good things about them, and I and two or three buddies joined the Navy Reserve. And after about 2 or 3 months of going to it, it was so boring and stupid, I quit. And the Korean War was breaking out, and it was serious crap. But you could quit. And to go to the men's room, you had to unbutton 13 buttons. This whole thing was so stupid, I quit. And they let you quit. Isn't that great?
Yeah.
So then the damn war breaks out, and my guys all go to the Missouri, which is out here to look at for tourists now, and shot bombs at everybody and all that. So that, okay, so I was in the Army. Then I go to Penn State, and that's land grant school. Lincoln and somebody like that said, you gotta have everybody, if they're gonna be federal backing, as I understand, go to a military thing, ROTC. And I did. But then I think I was in the Air Force. Yeah.
You did?
I don't know. Maybe I was in the Army again. I wasn't in the Navy, but I was in the ROTC for 2 years.
Wow.
And then because I needed money to keep going, I hadn't gotten a good job, which I did later at State College, where Penn State got renamed from being a farm field. I said, okay, oh, they had a hotshot guy in the sophomore Air Force thing, knew he'd suck engineer nerds like me. We're gonna make a helicopter that has a jet on it, and we'll do it, but I'm gonna leave it, the next guy will take it up, and blah, blah, blah. I mean, that's bullshit. Then you come there and nobody knows. Even when I went to the first class, I couldn't find the class because they changed it, and it's a mile campus, and I got tired walking, and I quit before I even left. Then you could quit, fortunately, and I quit again. So anyway, meantime I had a blue uniform or whatever color uniform they had then, but anyway, I was in three different services, and
wow.
I don't brag about it or anything, but it was things I was forced into doing to try to exist somehow, yeah.
So you never went to a boot camp?
Never went to a boot camp. No, I'm ashamed to say.
So when did you work in the bowling alley? What year?
Oh, well, to earn a living and to get money, I had to do something, and they didn't have robots to do pin setting. They had humans, and that's the dumbest job. Yeah, I did that for a year or two there, or I guess. I mean, that's about the second year there.
At college?
Yeah, at college, yeah. But then there was some engineering companies starting up there, and that time I had enough engineering terminology and savvy to get a job with them. And by the time I graduated, I'd worked with them a year and a half or more. And I could buy a car and all kinds of stuff while I was going to school. So that helped.
Did you ever tell your dad, wow, look what I did? I mean, he never wanted you to go to college. Did he ever say you did the right thing?
My dad really never talked that way. No. No, I guess he appreciate it, or maybe I was dumb, not smart enough to pick up on what he was saying, but I never sensed that.
How about your mom?
She too, I'm sorry, maybe I'm wrong there. But they both liked me and were happy about me and all of that. But I never felt anything strong coming otherwise, yeah.
Okay.
And maybe it's because I'm stupid and missed it, yeah.
How he met Mom?
So, there.
Well, okay, so how soon after out of college did you meet Millicent Darby? Millicent Coleman.
Okay, I'm graduating at a time where engineers were in big demand. Yeah. Man, I could have worked for anybody, any place. No. Mechanical engineers, what was happening? The Korean War was closing down, and God, it was terrible. Anyway, I interviewed different places, like IBM. IBM means I'd been moving, is what we thought, joked about. But they paid top dollars, and I went to IBM and up in New York State, and they told me they'd put me this place and they'd get me in the right golf course or golf country club and on and they do this and I'd have a lovely house and a lovely place.
Wow.
On and just guaranteed forever and ever and
that's what Grandma
and stuff like that. A couple companies like that, yeah.
Wow.
And why didn't you do that?
Because I was confused myself because I wondered if I even wanted to get into more engineering. During high school college at Penn State, the junior year and the senior year, I decided maybe I don't want to be an engineer. It's really yucky.
Yeah.
Meantime, I'd taken some art courses at Penn State and things. And my dad was an artist. And I was supposedly a good drawer and stuff. So I said, maybe I want to be more artistic, industrial designer of something, design better toothbrushes or lamps or something like that. And I thought, well, that sounds better to me than some of the alternatives of being a pure engineer, making bigger bombs and better bombs. So I went that way for a while. And that's when my dad once did speak up. He said, you do that. You're going to have to spend another year living by yourself trying to figure out what to do. It's going to extend you. And he wasn't supportive of it.
Wow.
So I said, okay, I'll go back to engineering. I went back.
Was he like more practical than ideally?
No, I think he was practical.
Yeah.
I don't know where I would have ended up if I went otherwise. I don't know.
Yeah.
But I didn't get support to try something different. No.
Wow.
So that happened.
So where did you go? How did you end up meeting Millicent?
Oh, Penn State. After I graduated.
Yes.
What job?
Yes.
Where did you meet Mom?
Oh wait, I'll get around. Let's get the job thing first. what job to take? Oh, I said, what the hell do I like? Oh, yeah. I got so pissed off and bored at college, mm-hmm. being a mechanical engineer. I rented a garage in an ex-landlord. And built a boat. I built an 8-foot pram boat, which was actually a moth sailboat, but it was heavy and stuff. But I got tools, and while I was studying doing all that other crap, I loved doing the hand tools and stuff like that, and did that, and I had this damn little boat, right? And hardly any place to sail it in the middle of Pennsylvania and little lakes and things,
yeah.
or time between going to school and all that crap.
Uh-huh.
But I did that, yeah. Okay, so I forgot about that. So what was your question?
Well, I just want to know wherever you ended up to meet Mom.
Oh, why? Okay. At least I like boats, okay?
Okay.
My dad always talked boats with me. I built a damn boat at college when I shouldn't have. So, okay, where's a good job? So the Bureau of Ships, that doesn't even exist now, gave me a job as an apprentice belly button designer. You know what that is? That's a naval architect. I said, wow, that sounds like a good job. So anyway, I took that job. That's how I got to Washington. How do you like that?
And then where was Mom?
Mom! Oh, yeah, then I met Mom. Okay.
Wait a minute, you've got to go to the university, back, you got to teach.
What?
You were teaching at the University of Maryland when we met.
Well, wait a minute, I haven't gotten there yet, no.
Yeah.
Okay,
no,
okay.
I
said, So I took the job, and then I had to go to Washington. So the car I bought at school was a 1936 Chevrolet, four doors, yeah. And that was like 2 years. I'm 32, 36, about 4 years older than I am, younger than I am. But anyway, it was a pretty crappy old car. And anyway, so I had to get my boat I built on the roof. I got roof racks back then, Bill, of some kind. And I took that damn boat from Penn State to Washington, D.C.
Wow.
On air. To work at the Bureau of Ships as a naval architect.
Did you go by yourself? Or are you driving down the highway with a car?
Oh, yeah. Oh. Damn tootin'. And the car, I couldn't afford, to put your water system in.
Radiator?
The radiator fluid. But so I had been running in the car on kerosene in there, which is dangerous. It worked, but if it leaked, it could. I think I changed back to regular stuff before I went to D.C. But anyway, I went that way where I met John McKinney. And he ran a bachelor house in Washington, D.C., just on the other side of Memorial Bridge on the Potomac River. And that's where the entranceway to the bridge, you have these beautiful big horses. But as you come from Virginia to go into D.C., you're looking at the horses' asses. I said, what a way to have people enter. They should turn the damn horses around. Anyway, this place was right near there, and they had no high rises or anything there then. It was a big wooden house, like Bill and Ginny bought this greenhouse up there. It was a big, dumb house, but run by bachelors that were all crazy like me, yeah.
Wow.
Cool.
So that happened.
Did your boat go in the water finally?
Well, yeah, finally, yeah. In fact, I dated some ladies using that boat. And one was, who am I trying to think? Lord. Who's
Lee Lord.
Was
it Nene?
Mother.
Audrey.
I dated Audrey Lord.
No way, you dated Audrey Lord?
And
she's a crazy lady.
And she kissed me. Yeah. Oh, never mind. Well, I don't have to go into this. No.
I didn't know that.
Well, watch. Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah.
That's okay.
Oh, okay.
That's funny.
Why did he go to the other? Why did he change jobs?
Why'd you change jobs then?
Change jobs? What do you mean? What job did I have to change?
You're a naval architect.
Oh, good point, Ron. Yeah, okay. I mean, they were designing all these boats, and I kept telling about, I'd been studying new kinds of things where they say small boats should act like fish and swim, and I talked to them about stuff like that. But they liked what I did overall, basically, but I got bored. A lot of things were so interesting. I should have stayed with them. I mean, they still use wooden parts, and fiberglass was new to them. PLC, fiberglass reinforced plastic, was all new to them. They were slowly getting away from wood in all their small boats. And they talked, in the plans, you would show a curve that had to come from a wood-growing tree that had certain dimensions and things, and then dry it properly to stick it up there.
Wow.
I mean, is it a million out of plastic or PV? I'm not putting them down. They were a bunch of neat old guys, and they liked me, and I liked them, but I wanted to get the hell out of civilization, yeah. Above all, that's what I wanted to do.
Okay.
And that drove me to quit and try to find a job. Oh, I found a boat to quit on and go to the Caribbean. And it was a dumb decision, but anyway. And it goes on and on. So maybe I would have bid. Yeah, yeah.
Should we take a break now? Do you want to?
Yeah, I got it.
We've covered a lot of time, Dad, and it's very interesting to hear what your life was like.
Yeah, that's cool.
Well, you're getting to the best part now. Yeah.
Right. Well, I'm going to turn the camera off now, okay?
Wonderful, man.
Right. We can do it another